I've tried in vain a thousand ways, my fears to quell, my hopes to raise. But what I need, your word I said, is ever only Jesus. You lived, you live, you reign, you plead. There's love in all your words and deeds. This weary heart finds all it needs in ever only Jesus. I want to know you, Jesus my Lord, King of the heavens, King of my soul. I trade my treasures and all my rewards, Jesus, to know you, then know you more. Though some should curse me for your name, I have no fear, I have no shame. You stand with me for all my days, my ever only Jesus. I want to know you, Jesus my Lord, King of the heavens, King of my soul. I trade my treasures and all my rewards, Jesus, to know you, then know you more. Like wave after wave on the ocean, like all of the sand on the shore, your beauty and glory are endless. Oh, Jesus, I must know you more. Like wave after wave on the ocean, like all of the sand on the shore, your beauty and glory are endless. Oh, Jesus, I must know you more. I want to know you, Jesus, my Lord, King of the heavens, King of my soul. I trade my treasures and all my rewards, Jesus, to know you, then know you more. Jesus, to know you, then know you more.
Know what that means? Praise the Lord. That's all it means. Praise the Lord in all languages of the world. Hallelujah means praise the Lord. Anybody ever say hallelujah here? I do once in a while. I was off the grid for a week, kind of resting my mind. And seeing how it feels, and I like what I feel, I think I should go back again. But it's not going to happen. We got work to do. We got to tell people on what's coming and what's on ahead. The lying spirits that we were talking on, preaching on last week, are permeating all walks of life. Many, many young people don't have a clue what realism is. they're walking in a dream. Many of the churches have no clue on the end times. They've been too busy making a lot of money and catering to the masses. Now, all of a sudden, when the chips are down, there's confusion, there's fear. People don't know what's on the horizon. I want to talk a little bit today about how God shows us not to be in fear. If we study the Word of God, if we know His heart, then we'll understand that He's in control. He brings down governments, He lifts up governments. I remember when Napoleon wanted to bring in a one world government, Napoleon of France, and he was defeated at Waterloo. I remember when Hitler tried to bring in, I don't remember it, but I study all these things. They tried to bring in a one world government. Das tausendjährige Reich, Deutschland über alles, didn't pan out very good. Poor guy destroyed Germany, took it down with him. Then the European Union decided we're going to make a one world government. And whereas a few nations combined, there's usually disunity. And now we're seeing it falling apart. But underneath it all, there were the globalists, and they were financed by millions and millions of dollars. And a lot of people who are globalists, for some reason, are Jewish people. They hate themselves. Some Jewish people hate being called God's people. They hate God with a passion. They're into devil worship, just like in the old days. They hate God, and they're trying their best to bring in this globalist agenda where they're going to have a utopia here on earth with God out of the picture, them calling the shots, and God sits in heaven, throws back his head, and he laughs. Why? Because he has a plan. The plan is written in the book. We're going to have a one world government, and it's going to come on God's agenda. It's going to come on God's timing. Next week, we're going to see some very interesting stuff going on with the election in the States. And I will be very, very surprised if we're plunged into a one world government, because I believe there's still some work to be done. God's representatives, the ones holding back, are still here, holding back that evil that is supposed to come. The Bible teaches us, though, one day the one holding back will be taken out of the way. Then shall the wicked one be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the brightness of his coming. So, is he here? No, he's not. He's not on the horizon yet. Is Trump the Antichrist? No, he could be the last Trump before the Antichrist. So, watch what you're getting into. Don't be confused. Remember, God is in control. It doesn't matter what the world thinks. It doesn't matter what agenda the world has. They will have to bow to the agenda of God. And God's people are the ones determining how fast and how slow this goes, because he has programmed to pray. He has programmed them to pray, to ask, to intercede. I know one man of God. I've been watching him for years. The Lord has him going to the White House month after month after month to decree God's will over that place. And he said the Lord had shown him his will be done. Satan can't stop it. The globalists can't stop it, who are run by Satanists. And another thing, God's people still pray. There's many out there who still love the Lord, who still know who Jesus is. They're not confused by these teachers who want to bring in damnable heresies. They still know who their God is. So I want to teach on an interesting subject today, which I had to work on last week. For those of you who are here, it's not necessarily meant for you, but maybe it is meant for you, because I didn't know who was going to be here. We need to stand fast, but we also need to understand what the beginning of God's agenda is for your life. And that is called being born again by the Spirit of God. So before we get into this, let's rise and ask the Lord for blessing. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your grace, for the mercy you have shown us, and Lord, for the word you have kept for us, Lord. There is no confusion. We can stand strong if we dare to believe. So, Lord, you'll open our hearts today in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated. I was watching and listening a little bit to the debate yesterday on YouTube. I couldn't stop my curiosity. And you know, when God sends those lying spirits, remember last week we were teaching on Ahab, when that lying spirit was told to go and be a lying spirit in the prophet's mouth, I can see the lying spirit in Joe Biden. I mean, the guy is forced to tell the truth in one part and to lie like a devil in the other. Like he is forced to tell the truth, he's going to raise the taxes. Who in his right mind will vote for him? And then he is forced to tell the people don't deserve what I'm going to do after I am elected. Who in his right mind will vote for him? So God basically allows people to see what's truly in his heart. To my opinion, you should be in an old folks' home and eating porridge with milk in it so that he doesn't choke on it. You know, the guy is just about on the other side, but they're propping him up with drugs and everything, and he's their mouthpiece, and once the election is over, he's going to disappear into the abyss. And God has him set up because throughout his 45 years in politics, he's been nothing but a curse to this country. He was out to steal, kill, and to destroy, and to fill his own pockets. It's just now coming to the surface. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 in verse 1, "Now I beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him, that you be not soon shaken." Listen to this. "Be not shaken in mind or be troubled. Neither by what? By a spirit, that's a lying spirit, or by word, or by a letter as from us, as the day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition." Here is a falling away. You see it all over the place. The way people are leaving Christianity. I mean, people you would never have thought are starting to doubt whether there is a hell. People who are accepting the idea that gay marriage is normal, that killing your child is a step in the right direction. Not only do they want to kill their child in the womb, they want to let them be born so the mother can decide whether it should be put to death. You can see doctrines of devils, teachings of devils, and people listening to. We've been enlightened, they say. We know more. I remember one preacher arguing with another preacher against homosexuality. And this one preacher said, "The Apostle Paul has it written down through the Holy Spirit that homosexuality is an abomination." And the other preacher said, "Yeah, but we're enlightened today. Paul didn't have the revelation we had." Is that a fact? He's listening to doctrines of devils. That's what he's doing. He's straying away from the blueprint. He's leaving the foundations, and they're changing the foundations and moving the markers, and people don't seem to realize it. It's happening all the time. For those of us who know Christ, we better hang on to what God is teaching us. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 6, listen to this. And now you know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work on the he who now lets, will let until he be taken out of the way. Then shall the wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. There is a force in this earth who is keeping back the evil. It's called the Church of Jesus Christ. And one of these days, that force that's holding back the evil will be taken out of the way. And then shall the wicked one be revealed. When you study chapter 5 of the book of Revelation, you can see the sea of glass filling up with millions and millions and millions of people. And they're singing the song of the blood of Jesus. So that's the saints of God that were taken from the earth. And then the seal is opened. And that's when the four horsemen of the apocalypse start to ride out to bring curses to this earth. And until this force that is called the one holding back, until that one is gone, the Antichrist cannot appear. I don't care how often the globalists try to bring their agenda to fruition. It's going to fail time after time. And next week, we're going to find out for sure, in plain sight, how these things work. If Donald Trump loses, get ready, because it's going to be very interesting, but I doubt it, highly doubt it. I'm not a prophet, but I see scripture, and he's going to win with a landslide, and things will change drastically. Why? Because God wants to prove to his creation how corrupt the human being is, and they will have a chance to see and repent and turn to him. For the Lord is willing none perish. He wants everyone to come to repentance. He says there's life and there's death. And I'm asking you, telling you, choose life. And one of these days, God will say, okay, you want this? You can have it. We'll see how far you'll go. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, it tells us, even him who's coming after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders. There's people out there who think Trump is the Antichrist. He's bringing peace. He's bringing prosperity. But Trump is not coming with lying signs and wonders. He's not performing great miracles. He's just doing the logical thing. He's making peace to prosper. He's making commerce to prosper through his intellect. He's trained himself like that throughout his life. He is a businessman. He knows what he's doing. But this guy here, the Mr. 666, he'll do it with lying signs and wonders. He'll do it like Joe Biden, lying through his teeth. Say, I told you we're doing the right thing. And in the meantime, here's how the left brings in jobs. They're creating jobs like being, you go out and you're an inspector of something. They make a law against this, they make a law against this. Then they hire a whole bunch of inspectors to make sure people don't break the law. That's how the left or the liberals create jobs. It's just jobs that come from your taxpayer. It's not a ground-up job, a grassroots job. It's a fake job created by the government. like giving a grant to a person at the University of Winnipeg, maybe I think it was $15,000 or $50,000 or something like that. I want to make a flax cookie to taste good. Do you guys remember that? That was given to the University of Manitoba by the Canadian government, trying to get a flax cookie to taste good. How brain dead can these people be? But that's what they've come to. It says he'll come with lying wonders, with all deceivables. Now listen to what it says here. With all deceivables of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth. They hate the truth. They hate righteousness. They hate God, that they might be saved. For this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie. Why? Why does he send them a lie? God sends those lying spirits to them, and they come as spirits that are telling the truth. I've told people quite a few times, you're listening to angels of light. That's not God speaking to you. That's a demon pretending to be God. Well, how do you know that? Because what he's telling you is not in the word. It's something that is made up. For this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned, who believe not the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. I'm telling you, people don't know how dangerous it is. What you sow, you will reap. If you like unrighteousness, if you have pleasure in that, you are going to start believing what you're doing is righteousness and truth. Just like the homosexual community. They're now saying, oh, this is going forward. This is doing the right thing. Where in reality, it's an abomination to God. It says God sends them strong delusion. If you wonder, what is going on with those people? Have they lost their minds? Why do they believe that stuff? It's because God has sent them strong delusion that they all might be damned because they have no love for the truth. That's the problem. That's the truth. You look at your own circle of friends, you look at your background, you look at your forefathers. The reason they believed in a lie is because they had no love for the truth. And this is what God allows to happen. And he says, I send it to them that they all might be damned. That's not me speaking it. That's me reading the words of the living God breathed through the Holy Spirit. It's the truth. We are living in a death struggle for a person's soul. And if a person does not want the truth, they're going to receive a lie. Interesting. I remember sitting down with a friend of mine. He had a Bible. I had a Bible. I explained the way of salvation perfectly to him. And he understood it. He understood it completely, and in the end he said, yes, it says in the Bible, but that's too easy. He preferred a lie. Imagine. And God allowed him to believe that lie because he had no love for the truth. And the truth is only in Christ Jesus. There is no other truth. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 1, finally, my brethren, pray for us that the word of the Lord may have free course and be glorified even as it is with you, that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men. We need to pray against unreasonable and wicked men because they hate God. Have you noticed in the States especially and here in Canada how they have shut down the churches under the guise of COVID-19. You cannot gather in church no more than 10 people. What's the difference in 10 people or 50 or 1,000? If you're in a room with one person, you'll get it. Never mind 10. You see, even their mathematics don't make any sense. But they're determined to shut down the preaching of the cross and the prayer people. It says here that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men. And let me tell you, we have wicked people in high places. For all men have not faith. Just pay attention to them. Their idea of God is something that it thing out there, the it thing that created all men, the it thing. They don't even know how to say it's God. They call it an it. Have you heard that? If you didn't, then check it out. It's really interesting. But the Lord is faithful. He shall establish you and keep you from evil. And we have confidence in the Lord touching you, that you both do and will do the things which we have commanded you. And the Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and into the patient waiting of Christ. That's for the Christian. He'll keep you. He'll direct you. He'll watch out for you. He's ever interceding for us. But where does that all start? Where is the starting line for the ones that God keeps? For the ones that God keeps from the confusion that is all out there. I'll show it to you, and it's clearly written. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 in verse 18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. Foolishness. But unto us that are saved, it is what? The power of God. This is what we depend on. The cross of Calvary. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. They think they're wise. They count themselves wise, but they become fools. So here we are, the preaching of the cross. To them that perish, it's foolishness. For me, that's my start for eternal life. When I believe in this cross of Calvary, in the finished work of the cross, that's my beginning in eternal life. That's when my wisdom and my intellect begin to grow and to reach out and to understand and to study. If you're not on that foundation, your intellect is only going to be influenced by Satan. All your righteousness will be only as filthy rags. You have to start with the cross of Calvary. If the cross of Calvary has no meaning to you, then you will perish. And not only for 25 years or 30 years or 50 years, it's going to be for eternity. The Bible teaches, for the smoke of their torment shall arise forever and ever, and their worm dieth not. So the start is the cross. The finish is eternal life, worshiping and praising this God that we serve. God is showing us the simplicity of it. We don't have to go to university. We don't have to go to India to find some guru that'll show us the incredible things of this world. All we need is a start by turning to this God and accepting Him as our Savior. And then God does the rest. He opens your minds. He opens your heart. The foolishness that you're in, that you were in, slowly turns into wisdom. And God starts working through you. Listen to 1 Corinthians chapter 1 in verse 20. That's in closing here. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Look out on them. You can see them. If you know Jesus, you listen to them for 2 minutes and you know they're full of the devil. And that's all their wisdom has. Where is the disputer of the world? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of their wise? Look at the foolishness. They think they have a good plan. They think they're working against God. But God is laughing. He's going to destroy them. For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. Worldly wisdom throws God out of the picture. How? Oh, we come from a blog in the ocean somewhere. Evolution is the big deal today. Young people are so into evolution. When you talk to them about God, they figure you're crazy. Atheism, and then on and on, these strange things come to the front, and you wonder, where have you gone wrong? It is because they knew not God in their wisdom. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. Me telling you that Jesus saves is what God used to save people. I don't have to prove him to you in a lab test or in a test tube. I don't have to prove him in any which way or form. All I do is tell you that Jesus loves you. He died for you on the cross. He took your sin there and nailed them there. And if you dare so much as believe one little bit, God will take you to the rest of the world. This is why these intellectuals cannot accept the truth. They want to see proof. They want to see scientific proof. They want to see God calling out. They want to see him do stuff. And even then, if he would, they would still reject him because they cannot take the simple plan of salvation. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish. Foolishness, it's foolishness to them. But to us that are saved, it is the power of God. That's where I hang my hat on. And let me tell you, it's going to be there for eternity. I'm not going to be cast out. I'm not going to be discouraged. I'm not going to be at the end, oh, what happened? Did I go wrong? No, the Bible assures me you're going to stand strong and true because you have an intercessor that's always standing in the gap for you. And that's called my Jesus. Is Jesus standing in the gap for you? You got a chance today to turn to him. Hallelujah. Those on the internet, those who are listening on the internet, we're heading for some confusing times. The gospel is simple. The preaching of the cross, it's simple. It's not foolishness. It's what God chose to save the world. And if we do not take it by faith, then we're telling God that he is a liar. He cannot be true. So God is giving us this simple little formula. And if you turn to that and you believe what he says, then he'll open your mind to an incredible horizon that you will not even be able to grasp for the rest of eternity. It's just going to keep expanding. So open your heart to this. Become a blessing to yourself and become a blessing to those around you. Hallelujah. Let the Lord bless you. Amen.
Every eye shall see, every ear shall hear the sound of angels when he comes, when he comes. Every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that he is Lord when he comes, when he comes. And he'll plant his beautiful feet upon this mountain, and the dead of all the ages who believed on him will rise. I'll be one in the first resurrection when he comes, when he comes, when he comes. Everyone then will know that it's him, really him, the one. comes, and he'll plant his beautiful feet upon this mountain, and the dead of all the ages who believed on him will rise. I'll be one in the first resurrection when he comes.